Aloha and welcome again to Condo Insider, Hawaii's show about association living. We've said many times some number between 30% and 40% of our population lives in an association, whether it's a condominium or a homeowner association or co-op. And we're all governed by some very strict laws here in Hawaii. And this show is all about teaching board members and owners about the various issues before our industry and trying to give you some helpful advice. We began a very ambitious project 3 or 4 shows ago to review Hawaii condominium law, HRS 514B. And we used as our resource, the Real Estate Commission came out with a course that realtors were required to take this year for continuing education with regard to 514B. And we're kind of using that as our template for this show. And this is Scott's fourth time on the show, I think, in a row.
In a row, yes.
And you've been on the show a couple other times previously.
We've had fun before. Yeah. I'm not sure about last week, but yeah, we've had fun before.
Well, I appreciate you driving me to drink. It's one of the nicest things you've ever done.
I didn't have to drive you far, though.
that's true. But anyway, Scott's director of training for Associa. I'm not going to go through his background again because we have a very ambitious schedule to get through this class or this on 514B. And I'm not going to summarize what we've done before, but I encourage you to go on YouTube at ThinkTech Hawaii and look at the prior shows where we talked about government structure, government process, and now we're going to talk about fiscal matters.
Yep.
But before we do that, like we've done every show so far, I've got to go back and review the last thing we didn't get done in the last show. And we were talking about document production. We talked about the law and all the things that you have to do in document production, but we didn't get down to the fact, do owners get document production for free?
And no, they don't. Well, it depends. Normally, no. There is the allowance to charge minimal fees to gather the documents, put them together, copy charge. There are some instances where some of the documents might be free because the association may have it up on a website. May not have all the documents, but they may have common ones up on the website. So generally speaking, an owner will pay up to, in one instance, up to $1 a page for copy fees. Now, I don't think most of the management companies charge $1 per page, but it was interesting where they came up with that amount at the legislature.
Where did they come up with that amount?
Well, there's actually a law on the books that says if I go into any state office and request a copy of something, they cannot charge me more than $1 per page. And so they sort of took that same idea out of that statute and moved it over into the condo statute so that there was at least a cap on what you could charge for copy fees.
Yeah, I would caution owners about that because the law is patently clear that they want owners to have documents, mm-hmm. and specifically ones that aren't going to harm the association. There might be some legal opinions or executive session material they're not entitled to under the statute.
Yes.
And they want to make it affordable, so they have this $1 per limit, which I think most management companies don't charge for. However, it does say in other administrative fees.
Exactly.
And when I see owners get into trouble, they get hoo-hoo, get really angry about something, and they write the management company, and they take the exact list of the documents. I want all the invoices, I want all of the letters, I want all of the governing documents, all the financial statements, all the check registers for the last 10 years. And they're angry, they don't think through it. They just want everything so they can sifter through it. And not realizing there may be 20 or 30 boxes of material in a warehouse somewhere.
That's right.
That they're gonna have to pay to have it picked up, brought down there. And then if they wanted a copy of every one of those things, it could be 20,000 pages. If they said 10 years, and I've seen 10 years.
I have as well. And, you know, the other thing to consider in there is I think you said it correctly, where they're not thinking it through. If you're asking for all these documents for the last 10 years, you know, maybe only in the last 2 or 3 years have they been digitized. But going back 10 years, those documents are not likely to be digitized. That means putting them on a truck from the warehouse, bringing them over to the office, start making the copies. And remember, that dollar per page is for copy, not administrative fees to do all this.
Because here's the other point. You call and you want all those documents, you bring them down to the management company's office. Maybe you have litigation going at the management company. They're not going to give you access to those documents for you to go through before you copy them. unless they have an administrative person sitting there to make sure you don't add a document that didn't exist before, right, or take a document that's harmful to your case. So when you go in and you take huge amounts of documents and you want to look through them, they may decide to put an administrative person there to protect the association, yes, that someone can't take something they shouldn't take and or add something that wasn't there in the beginning. So it's not a cheap process. And the best thing I can advise owners to do is think it through what you're really trying to get information on and narrow it down to something reasonable, even to the extent take some initial information, which may be minimal, before you even ask for additional information. Try to work through the process than just get hoo-hoo and say, I want everything for the last 10 years.
That's an extremely good idea. Also, we have to realize that your typical owner normally isn't asking for all those things. So they're asking for things like recent financials and stuff like that. But you and I both have experienced the, we want the 10 years worth of this. And they're also allowed to come down and review them.
Right.
You can make them available to them at your office or a convenient location, so to speak. And again, that same issue comes up. Somebody may have to be there to watch this entire process to make sure that something isn't taken that shouldn't be taken and things like that.
Well, we actually one time caught an owner trying to take a document because he was involved in litigation, and the administrative person caught him trying to, because he had his papers and notes and he's moving papers around, but he tried to take a document that was adverse to his position and kind of hide it with his papers, and we caught him at that. And so we told him we're going to double the administrative people now because of this, and we put a note in the record because of that.
So, and then the owner pays for that cost.
Yeah, but before moving on to the fiscal thing, I'll just say one more thing. It's important that boards give owners access to the documents they're entitled to see. Don't put roadblocks up. Yeah. Just make them available. And we remember we have to be cautionary about the quantity and what we do to protect the association, that process. And as the world becomes more digitized, it becomes much easier,
yes,
to provide documents. So anyway, let's move on to fiscal matters. Fiscal matters usually means budget assessments and reserves.
And reserves. Your specialty, as a matter of fact.
That's what I've been told.
Or anyway, what you've led me to believe.
Let's keep it in simple terms for the owner. What is the budget?
Well, the budget is just like a household budget, where you're budgeting how much to pay for groceries and the electric bill and things like that. That's the same thing a board's got to do every year, is budget and plan what the expenses are going to be for the next fiscal year or calendar year, depending on how they're set up. And based on that, they will know what to collect in monthly maintenance fees or assessments for the coming year.
That doesn't work in my home.
My wife doesn't work in mine either. But
my wife says you get a dollar a week and you can do whatever you want with it, and the rest of it I'll take care of everything else. And
she actually gives you a dollar. Boy, she's more generous than mine.
Yeah. So, but anyway, in the condo world, a budget is basically an estimate, mm-hmm, of your expenses, and at the same time, you're going to have to balance that with income, which is assessments.
Yeah.
And that's kind of what a budget is. It's a forecast. And my experience on budgeting with associations, nobody wants to raise, I hate the word maintenance fees, because it's more than maintenance, because you have insurance, you have all, yes, sorts of other costs. It's an operating fee. If you're too unrealistic about it, you're not able to collect enough money from the owners to pay your bills or fund the reserve, which is another statutory issue that you have to do. So, but in simple terms, budget, estimate of expenses and income, and an assessment is what you charge the owners.
And I think you hit the nail on the head. It is an estimate. Can a board be wrong in their estimate? And we have emergency situations that pop up that were not planned for, even in real life. And so boards can make mistakes and not be held liable for those mistakes because they were using their good business decision at the time. But you and I both know, and we've seen it happen, well, let's see what we can do to reduce the maintenance fees. And sometimes you end up cutting so tight that you create more problems than you can fix.
Well, for clarity, we always talk about maintenance fees, and that's the word we all use. Yeah. But the reality is, in the statute, they're called regular assessments.
Yes, they are.
And that's where the term special assessment comes, when there's an additional charge during the year, either on a one-time or monthly basis because of typically some unknown condition that's come up, and that's why it's a special assessment. But in the statute, when owners and board members talk about maintenance fees, they're really talking about regular assessment with respect to what it is, you know, with respect to that. And the problem I see is that, and typically this was true in, I want to say 2008, but what happens is boards got so conservative with budgeting that they didn't see the sudden rise in utility costs.
Yes.
And so all of a sudden they budgeted, let's say, $10,000 a month for utilities, and they were running $14,000 or $15,000 a month in utilities. And so what happens? They're short $4,000 or $5,000 a month, right?
Yes.
So what happens? The reserve fund doesn't get funded, and that's the problem.
Well, and we see that from time to time. Say a board in January of this year, based on previous year's estimates, have determined the electricity is going to, say, run $10,000 a month. Tomorrow, a barrel of oil could go over $100, and that does affect your common area electric bill, and the next thing you know, you're running short every month. So you can have a problem if you are too conservative and not taking certain things into effect.
Well, I think realistically, in the last couple of years anyway, because the price of oil has gone down and utilities is at a much lower level than normal, that associations have been able to minimize increases or avoid increases because they've had a savings in utilities because of the price of oil. And I would caution everybody out there, that's going to change someday.
It is.
Everything goes up and down, and there's going to be eventually pressure again on associations and their budget because of rising utility costs at some point in the future down the road.
Well, I've recently had this discussion in regards to whether or not maintenance fees need to be raised. And, you know, a very good CPA told me one time that a good association should be raising their maintenance fees about maybe 3-4% a year just to keep up with the cost of goods. Because you do run into boards that cut, and then 4 or 5 years down the road, now they got to pay the piper. And so instead of having a, let's say, a 3% increase every year, they now have to do a 15 or 20% increase. So the idea behind that is, do you pull the Band-Aid off slowly, or do you just rip it off and do it all at one time?
Yeah, because I hate to say, show me the money. It's all about the money, you know. I was talking to a board that had problems because they had a $10 million cast iron pipe problem. Mm-hmm. And so it's like, well, someone else is to blame but me. We have to fix the pipes, but I want someone else to have to pay for it. Well, government's not going to pay for it. Let's hold the board of directors responsible. The statute gives them immunity in the sense that they did the best they could. You know, and even if they don't do the best they could, they're really limited to the cost of forcing them to do a correct reserve study. They're not responsible for the $10 million that they're short in the budget. And it's the owner's property, so they have to find a way to pay for it. And there's loans and other ways to deal with it. But more times than not, reserves don't get funded because they don't put enough energy in a reserve study. And two, they have these increases in operating costs or surprises, and they don't fund their reserves. And so then they're not even meeting the reserve study they originally anticipated. And it's probably no different than our state government. You look at the hundreds of millions of billions we're short in funding University of Hawaii improvements and all the rest of it. It's all about the money.
Yeah, and it always is.
And that's what you got to deal with. So we talked about the basic definitions. Let's just review briefly the mandatory disclosures that must be included in the budget. So when the board puts out a budget, there are mandatory disclosures that should be in writing as a part of that budget when it's mailed to the owners, because they have to provide it to the owners every year.
They do.
And what are those mandatory disclosures?
You threw me. You wait till the show.
You know what we're going to do? Because I need you, you need time to think about it, even though I wrote them all down on a piece of paper for you, so you can look at them and not miss any of them. Because we're on the verge of a break, we're going to take a one-minute break, and you can read these 472 items and study how to do them in 90 seconds.
Thanks for watching ThinkTech Hawaii, and look forward to seeing you at Education Matters on Tuesdays with me, Carol Monley.
Aloha, my name is Justine Spiritu. This is my co-host Matthew Johnson. Every Thursday at 4 p.m. on ThinkTech, we host the Hawaii Food and Farmer Series. We like to bring in folks from the whole realm of the local food supply and agriculture, anyone working on these issues, any organization or individual that has plans or projects. What kind of people have we had on?
So we've had farmers, we've had chefs, we've had people from government, larger institutions, everyone who's working to help make Hawaii's local food system that much better.
So you can see us every Thursday and join the conversation on Twitter, and we hope to see you there.
Welcome back to Condo Insider. We're sitting with my buddy Scott Shirley talking about 514B and fiscal matters, and I was giving him a lot of heat that we're going to talk about what the statute says. You must have disclosure in your budget. And I want to say, before you answer that question, I would say 90% of the condos I see the budget fail to include these statutory disclosures. There ought to be a cover page that answers these basic issues.
Yes, there should.
And they should be clearly defined for their own protection. And even though some of them are within the budget itself, some of them are not. So back to my original question that I gave you a hint where to find the information.
Well, you never warned me when you're going to give me a test, but there should be an estimate of revenue and expenses. Of course, where are you going to start from? Of course. What are you going to get in revenue and what are the expenses going to be? Is it done on a cash or an accrual basis? The total for that particular year that's going to go into the reserve account. An estimate of reserves to maintain the property and explanation of how reserves were calculated. Reserve contributions, and whether it's percent funded or cash flow is used when creating that reserve.
So let me just add a little bit to that. It's pretty hard for you to say something about me wanting to interrupt and add something. Okay. Obviously, estimate of revenue expenses is pretty common. Here's how much we're going to spend on these various components, and we're going to get the money from you, the owner, through assessments. Cash or accrual basis. There's actually several fundamental methods of accounting. Cash and accrual are very different. Only accrual is generally accepted accounting principles. Mm-hmm. For some small associations, it's expensive to do accrual. You wouldn't do it on accrual. But if you want to know the difference between the two, go back to YouTube, ThinkTech Hawaii, when I interviewed Rodney Hirano, great CPA, who talked about the difference between cash and accrual accounting. Total amount in reserve account. You need to say at the end of that fiscal year prior to this budget, we had $300,000 in the reserve account. And then you need to say, we've done a reserve study and we're going to need X dollars over a certain period of time to maintain the project, usually in the millions if it's a big project and it's over 20 years. Then you need to determine how and tell them exactly how you calculated this contribution amount, because the statute requires to say, based on a reserve study, we have determined we need to collect from you this amount of money each month for the year to meet these future obligations. And the way that's calculated is not up for someone else to decide. There's national standards and in the administrative rules of Hawaii. And then you need to say what method you choose to do your reserve study, either percent funded or cash flow. If you don't understand that, go back to ThinkTech Hawaii when I did Kim Becker and Polly Wong. We talked about different types of reserve funding. I think I had Jonathan Billings on one time.
Well, let me throw one out at you then on that. What do you think is the most common type of reserve funding? Is it percent or cash flow?
There's no question in the United States of America and Hawaii that 98% of all condominiums use the cash flow method of doing reserve studies. And as much as you may not believe it, because it's back to different methods of calculation, if you were to purely calculate on a percent funded, we have to calculate each component separately, not in a pool like cash flow, 50% is actually more money than doing full funding with cash flow.
Yep.
It's a statistical anomaly. And quoting the great Mark Twain, who stole it from Benjamin Disraeli, there's lies, damn lies, and statistics. And so I would just encourage boards to know you need to have these disclosures in the budget. Make sure you have a sentence that answers these basic questions. Mm-hmm. We did this on the cash flow method. Our budget is based on the accrual method of accounting. you know, we have determined we need this amount of money over the next period. As of December 31, we had this amount of money in the bank. And just because it's on a report, having a summary sheet answering these basic obligations will only protect the board from any potential.
And you will see on a lot of, when owners want to resale and things like that, you know, a lot of the documents that the realtors use ask certain questions like, how is the budget prepared? And is the reserve study done on cash flow or percent funded? They want the buyers to know already, when they're thinking about buying in that complex, how certain things are done.
Well, this year we're going to review some of this in more detail, particularly with once the legislature's finished and some of the laws have changed a little bit. But it's topics that we just need to say to the owners out there, to everybody watching today, it's important you understand these disclosures must exist on the budget you send to the owners. And the budget to the owners, you know, has to be, people often think it has to be done, you know, fiscal year, December 31, January 1. Mm-hmm. So you have to have the budget out in November or December. Technically, that's not true. You have the ability to adopt an interim budget, amend your budget later during the year.
Yes, you do.
But the actual budget has to be out 30 days before your annual meeting. So you have a chance to say, look, we're not quite sure. We haven't got the final bids in on this. So we're going to adopt last year's budget for the first 3 months of this year until we have better data, telling your owners you're taking it more seriously before you raise fees or adjust things. But, you know, you don't really have to have the budget out by year end. You have to have it out 30 days before the annual
and
meeting.
And the statute makes it clear, too, that if your budget is going to cause an increase to the monthly assessment, you need to notify the owners at least 30 days in advance.
That's correct. Absolutely. So a major component of the budget is the reserves. So what is a reserve study?
Well, I particularly think the reserve study law is terrific because I came from a generation early on in real estate where you bought a condo and a couple years later, the board sends you a letter saying, it's time to replace the roof. Can you send us your portion of the roof is $20,000. Can we have the check next week? And unfortunately, that was the common way that a lot of condominiums operated. They just waited till something broke and then assess the owners. Now they're projecting each component of the building, the roof, the parking lot, and all the small other items in there as well. What life is left on it, how much is it going to cost later on to fix or replace, and then start saving for it. Wouldn't that be great if we did that on our own homes?
Yeah, it would be, but no one does. But the reality of this is that the argument going back to when the reserve law came in place was that developers intentionally kept the maintenance fees low to sell their units. And there wasn't a reserve study. So now there has to be a reserve study. It has to be a part of the budget. However, if you look at the current law, an association doesn't have to do a reserve study until the first year following the developer turning it over to the board, which means that the numbers in those estimated maintenance fee exhibits in a public report really are not based on a reserve study. It's based on industry estimates or wild guesses.
Exactly.
Another industry, their real estate commission recently has looked at amending the rules with regard to developers and looking for ways to maybe require more from the developer and calculating the reserve contribution.
And I think that particular issue that you're talking about comes up as well when you're taking, let's say, a 20-year-old building, apartment building, and converting it into a condominium. You have other issues there, but it's still viewed as a new condominium. As a condominium, it's new, but it was still a 20-year-old apartment. So there's some fine-tuning that needs to be done there as well.
So let me just summarize the reserve study, since that's kind of my kuleana. That number one, you have to kind of determine what your life expectancy of those components. So you may look at our elevator, and there's tables and manuals that say that has a useful life of 35 years. And then you say, well, my building is 20 years old, so I only have 15 more years left. That's the remaining life. Mm-hmm. The life expectancy is 35 years, remaining life is 15 years. And then you have to look at the estimated replacement cost based on 2017, since it's 2017, then apply inflation to it over the life of your plan, which is usually 20 years under Hawaii law. And then that comes back to calculate a contribution that each owner has to make to the reserve study as a part of the budget. And that includes some earnings on the investments of that money, although today investments are negligible, to say the least, you know. That being said, the components within a reserve study, you actually, by law, have to identify every item over $1,000.
Mm-hmm.
But you can assemble those into a component, like pool equipment,
yep,
and say that's $10,000, that includes the filter, that includes the pump, that includes things. So you do have the ability to take smaller items and consolidate them into a component and put them into a single reserve account. Then there's 50% funding versus full funding, which is, full funding is not 100% funding. The two differences between percent funding and cash flow are a lot of detailed technical terminology, which I'll say again, go back to my prior videos, and we're going to do one in the future too. But if you think about it, if you have a component that comes due under the statute, and you don't have enough money that all of a sudden by using money you align for something else, and so your reserve study now becomes less than 50% funded, yep, in that theory, the law says you have to assess them to make up the difference that year. You can't just phase it in. The law says if you borrowed from the reserves to pay for this when you meant it for that, if you're using the component method, which is the percent funded method, you have to assess them immediately to make up the difference. So there's a lot of risk and liability if they don't think it through, yes, you know, and unfortunately.
Speaking of that, since you are the expert and you've done numerous reserve studies, you know, I think there's a misconception out there that once the reserve study is done, that's all we need to do for a while. Should that reserve study be revisited from time to time and re-looked at, and some of the components may actually have lasted better or worse?
I'm glad you brought that up, because it's an annual requirement as a part of the budget. So every year they should take that reserve study, and if they did the painting and it cost $150,000 instead of $100,000, they should be adjusting in that,
yes,
study. Or they're looking at the elevator and said, you know, we have 10 more years, but our technician's telling us it's only going to last 5 more years. You should be a part of that annual budget every year, reviewing that reserve study and making adjustments, because you may not have made all the contributions you required.
That's right.
So you've got to every year do that. Now, if the board does make a mistake, heaven forbid, but they do, we all do, are they personally liable for the mistake?
Not if they've acted in good faith. You know, they're not trying to hide something. And I would say, for the most part, they do hire a professional to do this for them, because again, they're volunteers.
Right.
This is not their area of expertise to know how long the elevator is going to last or how long the roof is going to last. So a lot of times they would go to somebody like you to ask them about preparing a reserve study.
Well, we didn't get this all done, as I thought we wouldn't. We're at the end of this portion of the show. I do want to summarize by saying that, you know, the reserve study and the budget are very important parts of,
yes,
the whole finance. That's most of the problems in associations are money directed. I wanted to talk about owners' rights and withholding assessments, but we're going to do that next week if you're willing to come back.
I bet you can twist my arm to come back.
No, you're fired if you don't.
Okay.
But other than that, I want to thank you again for being here, and I want to thank our viewers for listening to us talk about budget reserves, probably one of the most important parts of an association. We'll be back next week, same time, with more about condominium HRS 514B. Aloha.